Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab series on magnetic position sensing. My name is Patrick Simmons, and I'm an applications engineer in the current position sensing product line. In this video, I will be covering the topic of transition detection using Hall effect sensors. To start off, let's look at some relevant applications, such as the opening of a laptop lid, a refrigerator door, and a house door with a security sensor. Do you see anything in common here? In each of these cases, we see a hinge-like movement followed by some sort of electronic response, such as a light turning on or off, or a buzzer beeping. Furthermore, we can generalize that there are two general states, and the transition point is near one of the terminuses of the operating range. In this video, we will discuss how you can implement this functionality using Hall effect switches. We will walk you through the general process, introduce key specifications, alert you of possible design challenges, and provide you with tools to streamline your design process. On that note, let's get started with the design process. The design can be summarized into these five basic steps. And the first, we'll be choosing the fundamental implementation. In these kinds of applications, there may be several different ways to monitor your moving component. For instance, you could use a cylindrical diametric magnet at the hinge origin that triggers a Hall effect switch when rotated through certain angles. Or you could possibly use a block magnet placed toward the extremity of the moving part to trigger the Hall effect sensor. Deciding which implementation is best for your design will largely depend on space constraints. In this video, we will work through the second example that is shown on the right, which uses a block magnet. Having selected a general sensing implementation, we can move on to the second step, which is defining our mechanical constraints, including tolerances. Upon revisiting the laptop application, you may notice that the off and on transition point are not exactly at the same point. Why would you want that? Imagine you purchased a laptop that flickered like this. While it might not affect the consumer's ability to play games and type a document, it does not exactly inspire confidence that the laptop was engineered well and therefore undermines the quality of the laptop. So, what is the issue here? The issue is that the position sensor feedback has either no hysteresis or insufficient hysteresis. Hysteresis is essentially a separation in transition points for operating in different states. In this case, the laptop lid light turns off when the lid is closer to the base than when the light turns back on. Hysteresis helps eliminate sporadic state changes that would be caused by fluctuations in the supply, electrical noise, magnetic noise, and mechanical vibration. Knowing that hysteresis is needed, we recognize that on and off points need to be defined at different points. However, just as insufficient hysteresis impacts user experience, so could too much hysteresis. In the case of the laptop, it could result with either the lid light never turning off when the lid is closed, or the lid light not turning on until it is at some unideal viewing angle. Therefore, some reasonable mechanical bounds should be defined for equipment state changes to facilitate a user-friendly design. After specifying our mechanical constraints, we now have a tangible path to take in selecting the components needed to create the position feedback system. The first component we will examine for the position feedback system is the magnet. There are numerous types of magnets available on the market. A key characteristic is the magnet's shape. Here are just a few of the dipole-shaped magnets you could possibly use. For this particular video, we will focus on the block-shaped magnet. The key metrics for block-shaped magnets are length, width, and thickness. Remnants, which can be found on a BH curve or specification table, is also important. The material the magnet is made of will determine the remnants. To provide some insight into how the aforementioned properties influence the magnet's strength, here are some helpful plots. In the upper left, we can see how the B field curve changes with different remanence values. N35, N45, and N52 are different grades of neodymium magnets with increasing remanence levels. N35 has a 1.2 Tesla remanence, while N52 has 1.46 Tesla remanence. Here, you can see that the magnetic flux does increase with increasing remanence. However, the change is relatively small. In the right plot, we see the impact of adjusting magnet width. While increasing width does increase magnetic flux, it looks like there are diminishing returns. In the final example, we see the impact of a thicker magnet. By far, this appears to have the most consistent dramatic increase on the magnet's field strength. Aside from the magnet's physical properties, its alignment with the device can have a profound impact on the measured magnetic flux. Such alignment specifications include the magnet offset relative to the hinge axis, the sensor offset relative to the hinge axis, the arc radius, the Y offset between the magnet and sensor, as well as the X offset between the magnet and sensor, as in this example in which the magnet is at 0 degrees. Here is an example of how adjusting offset affects the measured flux. We see that moving the magnet a few millimeters away on the x-axis leads to substantially less flux at the sensor that senses in the z-axis. This is due to the nonlinear behavior observed with magnetic flux with respect to the angle displacement or distance displacement. Upon determining the B curve characteristic for your desired magnet, we now can move on to the step of selecting a device. As we are essentially looking at binary states of open or closed, omnipolar and unipolar switches are a suitable option. Conveniently, all such devices from TI are designed with hysteresis, and the relevant specifications that define the hysteresis can be found in the magnetic characteristics table under BOP, BRP, and BHIS in the device datasheets. Typically, in an omnipolar switch datasheet, you will see an active low plot that indicates the sensor output will transition low when the measured magnetic flux exceeds BOP and will transition back to high when the measured magnetic flux drops below BRP. BHIS will define the difference in the magnitude between BOP and BRP. From this, we can create another general behavior diagram to help us anticipate what behavior to expect in our operating conditions. Magnetic field strength decreases the further you are from its source. Therefore, we can expect the sensor output will be typically high when the magnet is far away and low when the magnet is close. Similarly, we can then extrapolate such general behavior with respect to magnet sensor angle displacement. Now that you know the basics for selecting a device and understanding how it might work, there are some nuances worth mentioning. As previously mentioned, some hysteresis should intentionally be designed in to make the equipment less prone to noise. Wider hysteresis will make your equipment less susceptible. However, too much without proper design could lead to cases in which the transition state is reached in an unideal position or not reached at all, such as with device A. A narrow subregion within the bounded region of device A, such as device B, will have a narrower spatial transition region. Yet another important nuance to acknowledge is the field strength curve nonlinearity. Due to the nonlinear relationship between field strength and distance, where the BOP and BRP specifications fall on the B field versus displacement curve can have a significant impact on your transition region. Consider in this case that the B hysteresis specification is the same for both device A and device B. In this example, device A and device B have different sensitivities, with device A having a higher sensitivity capable of triggering from lower magnetic field strength than that of device B. As the magnetic field strength for the chosen magnet and magnet sensor placement levels off within this sensitivity region, device A will have a spatially large hysteresis region that may not be desired. As for device B, it is less sensitive, with both BOP and BRP balance set at a much higher field strength. As the magnet field strength curve slope is steeper in these BOP and BRP bounds, the distance between on and off states is significantly smaller. One other nuance to be aware of that might be directly related to Hall switch specifications is transition region variation. How much tolerance there is on BOP and BRP will influence how much variation you could expect between transition regions amongst identically designed equipment. Smaller tolerances on BOP and BRP will lead to the greatest repeatability from the sensor. As you can see with device A, there is a wide region of variation from either BOP or BRP in the graph, which means one laptop with device A might have the lid nearly closed for both on and off transition points, while another laptop with device A might have the lid at nearly 45 degrees for both on and off transition points. As for device B, the BOP and BRP tolerance is too small to be distinguished on the graph. Consequently, every laptop with device B has nearly identical on and off transition points. As the design involves more than just the sensor, we can anticipate that there will also be variation due to tolerances in the manufacturing of the magnet, the Hall element placement within the device package, the Hall sensor PCB, the system fixture, and the physical placement of the magnet. There is yet one other aspect that may appear to be a challenge to the uninitiated, which would be calculating the expected magnetic flux. Some of you may have already found equations for calculating the magnetic flux relative to your chosen magnet, such as this block equation shown here. And you might have also found that such equations do not account for offsets, such as the X and Y offset displayed in this head-on example. To further complicate that, you might have also found such equations as this one do not give you the necessary X, Y, or Z components you will need when the magnet is rotating on a hinge. Fortunately, there are remedies to this particular challenge. It's possible to use such modeling software such as finite element method magnetics, FEM, as well as ANSYS to tackle your most demanding magnetic conditions. Yet, these tools themselves may not be free, as well as they may require significant time to learn, build your model in, and get proper simulation results. Thankfully, TI has taken the liberty of simplifying the process even further with our own tool, which allows you to put in all relevant design constraints so that it can build the model and execute the calculations or simulations for you. Now equipped with the tools to help you quickly determine the expected flux you will measure according to magnet position relative to the sensor, you can now move on to the final basic step, iterate. Due to the nonlinear characteristic of magnetic flux and the number of variables that influence it, you likely will not have the perfect design on your first attempt. Therefore, you will likely need to revisit a prior step. The simplest option might be swapping out different sensitivity variants of the same device. The next simplest option might be sweeping through a range of offsets. Next would be to try a magnet with a different size or material. You might even entertain the possibility of a different sensor location or even a different implementation if the space constraints of the original target region are not compatible with the appropriate magnet. That concludes this video. Thank you for watching. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of the content. For more information and videos on magnetic position sensors, please visit ti.com/Hall Effect.